Hi, we're here at EC29 with Andrew Hessel. Andrew, why don't you tell us a little bit about yourself?
I'm hard to describe. I'm a troublemaker.
Good start.
I live a few years in the future. I basically, I'm called a futurist by some people. I tend to prefer the term catalyst. I like to go and play on the forward edge of things and spark things into action sometimes. I often get people together to go and try new things. By training, I'm a cell biologist and genetic scientist, but today it's largely working to introduce the forward edge of those technologies to a wider audience.
I saw part of your presentation today and it was fascinating. How did you get involved in this work? It's really unique.
It was a long story. I was a geek. I just loved anything mechanical or electrical. And when I really had to start thinking about my graduate career, I was starting to think, even before that, as soon as I finished high school, I was thinking, well, what do I go and concentrate on? And I'm obsessive compulsive by nature, so it has to be something important. And I realized I don't care about anything material, cars, buildings, it doesn't matter if it's insured, just replace it. It all ends up in the junkyard anyway. And then I realized, well, working on living systems is really fascinating, and we were starting to get some really good tools in molecular biology and genetics to do it. So I switched into that field and have been riding the waves of technology and advancement ever since.
Very interesting. Tell us a little bit about your company.
Humane Genomics is a company I founded I was working with Autodesk for 6 years, and I got to prototype synthetic viruses with them, and to continue that work, I founded a company to advance it. So basically we're making, the first project was to make cancer-fighting viruses, essentially viruses that give cancer cells a cold. They're designed fully synthetically. There's no starting biological material. We start with a design file on a computer. We synthesize the entire viral genome. Then we do standard cell culture work to boot up that genome, make viral particles, purify them, and then use them as cancer treatments in dogs.
That's amazing. Where are you in the process with
that?
Oh,
we've already done all the proof of concept. We've re-engineered the virus now. Okay. So we've made synthetic viruses. We were the first to make a synthetic oncolytic virus, they call it. And now we're refining the process, making it faster, making it cheaper, and making it automated.
That's amazing. I believe in your talk you said something about we do have the potential in the future to cure almost every disease or genetic flaw that exists. Where do you see that going first? What do you think will be the first thing we do?
So I tell people we basically have to cure cancer first, and here's why. Cells are the most complex machines on the planet, but let's take a less complex machine that we know more about. I usually say take a BMW. Beautiful car, very complicated. You open the hood, it's basically all electronics. We know everything about a BMW. Absolutely everything. We made every component, every chemical, every wire. But if it's not working right, the average person's never going to be able to fix it. And in some cases, even highly trained specialists aren't going to be able to fix it. They'll just have to start swapping out modules and hope it works. So we're not fixing a cell is 1,000 times harder. So trying to do things like gene therapies are very difficult. Now, if you want to destroy something, if you want to kill a BMW, all you need is a six-year-old and a hammer. Like, you just have to make sure they get the BMW and not the car beside it. So curing cancer is just about using the tools of biotech to selectively kill cells, and it's actually not that hard a problem. It's like making a very specific antibiotic. The challenge that we've had in the past is no two cancers are the same, but we keep trying to hit them with one-size-fits-all drugs. That just doesn't work. With the technologies that we're developing now, we can make customized therapies to the individual.
Wow. That would be incredible.
Mm-hmm.
Incredible to see.
Yeah, and it's not even expensive. The biopsy on the cancer will essentially drive the design of the therapy, and we expect that we should be able to achieve turnaround times in days as this technology matures.
That would be a remarkable advancement, I think. Anybody would appreciate that.
I call it moving from blockbuster medicines to Netflix medicines. How many,
right.
You know,
right.
The cheap subscription plan get all the cancer medicines you want.
Perfect. You also talked about hacking humans, which I think terror, there's a little bit of terror people have when you say that. So maybe you can talk about CRISPR, 24th yeah. genome, things like that.
So I'm one of the co-founders of the Genome Project, right? And people think that's about hacking humans, but it's not. It's just about building the core technologies and societal structures, things like ethics, things like standards,
sure.
that are necessary to do the engineering of large genomes. But even if we write a complete human genome, it would just we can run it in cell culture. We're not making human babies. That's well outside the scope of this particular project. That being said. People automatically go to the designer baby, and there I just have to point out, well, we've been hacking humans for a long time. IVF is probably the biggest hack, and now we've crossed the 40-year anniversary with IVF. What most people haven't heard of yet is IVG, which is going to be a game changer because it'll make IVF $500 or less and easy.
Wow.
You won't need ovaries anymore to produce eggs. Just a blood sample will probably be sufficient. And then CRISPR is really the forward edge of doing gene therapies.
Okay.
CRISPR is where we would, think of it as genetic surgery. So it's not something today that we'd be comfortable using to do cosmetic surgery,
sure.
But if there's a major error in an embryo, it's another tool that doctors have to do a surgical correction.
Wow. C24, can you talk a little bit about that?
I'm a big fan of C24 technologies. What we've been learning is our genomes are very plastic. Now, if we were, C24 technology is the opportunity, if you were doing IVF, to add another chromosome, an engineered chromosome that's basically preloaded with essentially all the fixes and all the additional software you might want for your child. It doesn't mean it's turned on. It
okay.
just means that it's all preloaded. Think of it as when we used to buy our PCs and they'd come preloaded with all the trial software. Kind of the same idea. You know, since you only have one opportunity to get every cell in the body loaded with extra code, and it has to be done in the lab with IVF, C24, I think, is the type of technologies we will develop first with animal systems, but potentially with humanity moving forward.
Very interesting. I believe you also talked a little bit about how we would be able to sequence the genome for every human on the planet in a relatively short time. I'd love to hear more about that. I think people hear sequence a genome and think it's an impossible or very time-consuming task.
It's not, actually. So DNA sequencing has been one of the fastest evolving technologies on the planet. So the first genome was completed in 2003. The draft was done in 2000, but the genome was complete in 2003. And since then, over the last 15 years, the time and cost of sequencing the whole human genome has just plummeted. Today, you and I could get a whole genome sequencing for under $1,000. I've been sequenced twice.
That's amazing. Yeah.
And it's only going to get cheaper. But what is interesting now is even at $1,000, people aren't rushing out to get sequenced. There's still some pretty significant barriers, cost being one of them. Doctor's approval is another. So what I'm seeing now is the emergence of second generation DNA testing companies that are removing those barriers and making it free for people, and learning how to build a growing economy that essentially is exothermic and allows it to scale to a billion. The way I describe it is, do you remember when you used to have to pay to get email?
Yes. Right.
You know, you don't have that anymore.
Like, okay. Yeah.
All of our web services are essentially provided for free because they generate an economy behind the scenes. Well, we're not going to go and create the same economy because it was very, the money flowed up to a small number of shareholders and owners, but we're seeing the appearance of a distributed economy today around genomes that I think will be beneficial to everyone. It'll give you access to better data about yourself. It'll give doctors and researchers better data about how to treat you or do basic bio research. And I like to point out, some people are going to become millionaires just because of the genetic lottery. The genome that they're born with is just incredibly valuable. And so I think we're going to see some really fascinating dynamics in the DNA sequencing world over the next 10 to 15 years. Like, this will accelerate quickly. I expect we'll have 50 million people sequenced in between 4 and 10 years.
It's very interesting. I'm sure you get asked a lot about privacy, ethical concerns. It's a huge topic area, but how do you address that, or how do you go about addressing that?
Privacy is interesting because really we don't have genetic privacy. Everywhere we go, we shed our genomes. So really, if we're going to put in some sort of privacy rule, it's going to have to come. It's going to have to come from the electronic side and from the regulatory side, because it's not hard to collect a person's genome, sequence
it. That's a great point. Yeah.
So I've suggested, well, maybe you have to be sequenced and copywritten, so that if anyone uses your genomic information without your permission, you hit them with a copyright violation. That something similar that provides genetic protections. When it comes to ethics, ethics aren't a really good guide, because everyone has a certain ethical makeup. So it's a spectrum. It's not black or white.
That's an interesting take on it.
And so I think in general our ethical positions shift over time as we become more comfortable with a particular technology or tool or service. But in this case, I think that it's really about the individual. I have no problem being sequenced and making my genome available for research, but I imagine if I was a master criminal, I would be a little hesitant.
Sure.
And again, if I had an interesting genome, and I don't, I'm you know, just an average person, boringly normal, my doctor says. If I had an interesting genome, then I'd be a lot more concerned about getting the appropriate compensation for my genome. It might be the one thing that gives me
sure.
a chance at being a millionaire.
What makes an interesting genome?
For example, you have lots and lots of hair on your head and you're 60 years old.
Okay.
You know, that's just one example. Or you're super tall. Anything, the way I describe it, you're a mutant, you're a freak in some way. And I say that in the nicest way. You're just, you know, two standard deviations from the mean.
Okay, very interesting. You know, you talked a little bit about cloning as well.
Mm-hmm.
Any thoughts on that?
Love it. I've always been a fan of cloning, but then I read and consume science fiction, and clones are an old trope in science fiction. I don't see any problem with clones. We have natural clones all over the world, identical twins. The only difference with a clone is that they're time displaced. Like, I look at clones as being pretty much organic. They're not genetically modified. They might have a watermark signature put in, you know, just to distinguish them. But really, it's not genetic engineering. It's just an extension of cell biology and IVF.
Okay. All right. What's next for you?
That's a great question. So the last big project that just graduated was joining this new genome-based economy, Nebula. So joining them as an advisor. Right now I've got a DNA synthesizer technology that I'm out raising money for.
Okay.
Just to go and take that beyond prototype. Of course, always trying to improve virus engineering, and we're trying to establish a virus factory here in the U.S. because there's no standalone, dedicated, vertically integrated virus factory, and I think it's time we have that as a public service. And a couple of other projects I'm not ready to pull the covers off.
Oh, interesting. So we'll have to talk again.
Yeah. Now that I'm part of this community, yes. I think I just have to keep coming back.
I think you do. And speaking of that, I know you're new and you're just getting started here, but what do you think so far?
Well, this is a community of people who are really professional, because the work that they do and the decisions that ultimately they're responsible for affect lives. And that's a big deal. So I was trained, I said in my talk, I was trained as a med lab technologist before I did my genetics graduate work. And so I understand that there's some results, that there's a life at the end of connected to that result. So you have to be very professional and run all the standards and not take any shortcuts. It's hard work. Today I'm fortunate that I get to play on the fringe. I don't invent anything. I just go and look at what's happening at the very forward edge, run it through my filters, bring it back. But this community has to be a little more conservative than me. But I, that, very true, Dean said, yes, they need to be aware of what's happening on the forward edge because it's going to change their work.
Yes, and I can see it happening every year. Something surprises us, I think. Thank you. Andrew, that was great.
Thank you.
Really appreciate you being here.
It's a pleasure. Thank you for having me.
Absolutely.